Hello, and welcome to KDAB News, the monthly update for professionals working with Qt, C++, and 3D technologies. I'm Robert Brock, and in this edition, we have something new for you, an interview format where we explore the useful background information on recent topics. Lately, I told you about the discussions around the Qt licensing. As we often receive questions dealing with open source licenses, we decided to ask someone who knew about it in detail. So, the topics are an interview about the benefits and downsides of open source software with Catharina, the lawyer and founder of the Software Compliance Academy, new version of Squish Test Center, some announcements, and resources. Open source software is a complicated topic and often raises uncertainty about what you are allowed to do with it or not. I'm glad to talk to Catharina Maracke today, who will give us some quick insights to the benefits and downsides of open source licenses. Hello, Catharina. Could you tell us what are the main benefits for businesses in using open source software?
Yeah, there are of course many benefits, and probably you can also talk about a necessity and not only a benefit. And that necessity goes back to the very old wisdom. Why would you reinvent something that already exists, right? So why would you develop code that is already existing? So in a nutshell, using open source components, open source projects, and so on and so forth, really help you and your company to reduce the development time. And that means that essentially you reduce your time to market. So I would say in today's competitive world, it's not even possible to work a successful company without using any open source components, because there's so much that is already out there and that already exists. So you would need to make a benefit of that. And then there's another point that I think is very important. Working with the open source community actually gives you access to a knowledge pool, right? So the community like has so many smart people, and working with them gives you the opportunity to really get new ideas, get new perspectives into your own company. So it helps you in terms of being innovative. It helps you in terms of hiring, because you have access to very good people. And also allowing your company or your employees to contribute to open source projects will probably make your company more attractive, because the most good open source developers, or the good developers these days, let me put it like this, really expect that they can contribute.
Excellent. Thank you. Would you say there are some downsides? What are those? And when is licensing a better option?
Yeah. So there are definitely downsides, and I understand that the question talking about licensing meaning proprietary licenses instead, right? So when we have this dual licensing model, you can use software either under an open source license or under a traditional proprietary license. So let me start with the downsides of using open source licenses. The problem that I can see is that open source licensing models are still very complex. So the ways in which all open source licenses are the same are still greater than the ways in which they differ, but the differences are still significant. And that makes it really complex. So the different open source licenses have to be recognized, understood, different license obligations need to be learned about, need to be understood, need to be fulfilled in reality. So how do I deal with that? How do I, you know, implement that in my product in reality? And that is not an easy task. So I think it's fair to say that using open source components comes with, you know, a very complex licensing situation. And that means that you need resources to, you know, deal with that. That's, you know, the benefit if you use a proprietary license, right? So you pay a fee up front, and all you need to do is to monitor if, you know, the volume and the time and all the kind of issues are, you know, taken care of. But open source, so to speak, comes with a package of, you know, you need to go through a learning process, and you need to understand and work with the details of the licenses.
Excellent. Yeah, of course. And What are the principal difficulties that your clients meet, and where do they ask you for help the most?
Yeah, so most companies really deal with the issue of compliance, right? So how do I handle these licenses? How do I make sure I have fulfilled all the license obligations? And the questions that we receive really range from a very broad, you know, just raising awareness. So we have many companies to come to us and say, well, we don't have a very specific concrete problem, but we understand that open source is important, and we want our employees, our developers in general, give them the opportunity to you know, learn the basics. And that means, you know, usually they do some trainings, or, you know, we write them like some kind of handouts or basics on copyright and all these kind of issues. Other clients come with very specific legal questions. So from, you know, unfortunately, some have been, kind of hit by a lawsuit or something similar. But in the most cases, that's really the exception. I should be open here. In the most cases, it's specific questions about license obligations. So in the context of the GPL, what does it mean that I, you know, can also offer or give a written offer instead of delivering the source code? These kind of, you know, legal deep dive questions on specific licenses. And then we also get questions that are more technical. So for example, is there any way to automate the compliance process? Is there any tool that I can, you know, use, some kind of license management tool? Or nowadays, many people talk about scanning the source code to see if there's any, you know, open source components involved that maybe that weren't clear enough in the beginning. So it's really a very broad range that companies ask for.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And do you see any emerging trends that might change this picture?
I don't see any emerging trends in terms of license compliance. I think that's more or less over the past 5 years, I would say, is pretty similar. I can see that on the German market, the companies are, you know, getting more involved in open source. And that means the questions that we receive and the mandate that we are working on are more sophisticated, right? So 5 years ago, it was really more like, oh, what is open source? Can you help me understand what that means? And today it's very specific. Like, we have an embedded product. We don't know how to, you know, deal with GPL license obligations. So how can I make sure I deliver all the license obligations correctly? So it's more deep dive into specific questions. I think that's the trend that I would say, that companies have really understood that open source is important, and they are now at a stage where they really want to get it right.
Yes. Thank you for answering the questions, Catharina. Our partner, FrogLogic, have released an update for their Squish Test Center. Test Center provides developers and Q&A engineers a centralized platform for aggregating, monitoring, and analyzing automated test results as software projects evolve. The latest release offers performance enhancements, convenience features, and usability improvements in every aspect of the platform. CppCon, the annual gathering for the C++ community, will take place from the 13th till the 18th of September in Aurora, Colorado, and the organizers announced it will be held under strict safety measures. Registration is open now. There's an early bird offer, and in case you change your mind after booking, there's also a no questions asked complete refund offer up to 30 days prior to the event. Check out the agenda and more information below. Also, Meeting C++, the annual C++ conference in Berlin, announced an in-person event for November 2020. The agenda is going to be released by the end of July. Below, you'll find further information from the organizers. And due to the current uncertain situation with the COVID-19 pandemic, Qt Company has announced to cancel Qt World Summit 2020 in Palm Springs. However, there will be a virtual Qt World Summit happening at the same time in October, when the original event would have happened. They announced an interesting new format that will be more than just a webinar. We'll keep you informed in the coming editions. After 4 months of intensive development work, KDAB's Marc Mutz announced that the first QString tokenizer commits have landed in what will eventually become Qt 6.0. While the version in Qt will be Qt 6 only, KDAB will release this tool for Qt 5 as part of its KD Toolbox productivity suite. That means the code doesn't require C++ 17 and works perfectly fine in pure C++ 11. To learn more about it, read the blog linked here. Thanks for watching, stay safe, and feel free to share any feedback below the video. See you next time.